Welcome to the Flame and Fiber Podcast. Take two. Welcome to the Flame and Fiber Podcast. It's Sunday, January 22nd, 2017. And I am Barbara. Welcome. You can find me on Instagram and Ravelry as Diva S. And I'd really like to say welcome to any new viewers who are just finding me. I really appreciate you checking me out. I know there are a million wonderful podcasts out there. I'm amazed at how I'm still finding really lovely podcasts that I've never heard of, never seen. And they have 20 or 30 or 40 podcasts. How is it I haven't found these wonderful people? I don't know. And if you're coming back and have watched me before and are coming back, I really, really appreciate that. Welcome to the new subscribers. I have some new subscribers lately. Excuse my glasses. And I really appreciate you who have decided that you'd like to spend time with me. I love it. And I love the wonderful comments. I've enjoyed interacting with the people in my group. Thank you so much for contacting me and leaving comments and sending me notes. I really, really appreciate it. Thank you so much. So this is a knitting podcast. Sometimes there's spinning, although there's no spinning lately. Well, that's not true. I actually spun some last week, but it wasn't very much, and it wasn't enough to show, but I am slowly working my way back into spinning. I have some beautiful red fiber I'm trying to spin, and so you'll see it. Maybe you'll see it next week. Maybe I'll make that promise that you'll see it next week. I need to put a page in my notebook. Promises for next week. I think I will do that. Promises for next week. See, this is a blank page. And I'll show you whatever I have. I'll show you. If I haven't done anything else, you can see what I have up to now. Joe's spinning. And sometimes lamp working. Lamp working is the art of melting glass over a torch and turning it into beads. This is an example of one of my beads that I've turned into a stitch marker. I haven't been doing much lamp working lately. I really burned myself out lamp working. There are some lamp working Facebook threads that are sort of an auction style of selling, where basically you put up a picture of your beads and you offer them for sale for 24 hours. And people bid on them in the comments, and it worked great, and I sold lots and lots of beads, which I found very satisfying, because it's wonderful to think that these makers want to use your beads to make their beautiful jewelry. Some of them were amateur makers who were just making jewelry for themselves, and some of them were professionals, and it was wonderful to see my beads in beautiful jewelry that a talented jewelry maker had made. But the way that worked is, you know, every day, you had to put, you know, there was a limited number of beads you were allowed to put up in any 24-hour period. And so it turned out to be a huge amount of work, which I was doing for months at a time. And Dennis laughed at me and said, you know, you're working harder now that you're retired than you did when you were working for a tiny, tiny, tiny fraction of the money you were making. And it was true, but it's very satisfying when people want to use your beads to something that you made to make something beautiful. So, I mean, it's very much like these lovely indie dyers who are dyeing beautiful yarn, and, you know, they're working really hard and it's a really hard job and they're really not making a lot of money on what they're selling us. But, you know, they must love it when people show their things that they've made with their yarn that they dyed. I'm sure it's very satisfying, because that's how I felt with my beads. But anyway, so these days too much lamp working because I'm slowly easing back into lamp working, especially now that I'm thinking about how to incorporate lamp working and my knitting, because knitting is the focus these days. I tend to be pretty focused on one hobby, I guess, and the other ones, you know, tend to maybe sometimes fall by the wayside, although I consider spinning and knitting sort of all of a piece. So, and I'm thinking about starting to dye some yarn for myself, and that, you know, they're all so interconnected into sort of the same hobby that it feels like the same hobby. My hobby right immediately before knitting was lamp working, and I was doing it a lot. And my hobby right before lamp working was playing poker. But I found when I was playing poker, I was still working and I was playing poker, and I realized that I was using all the same energy for the poker as I was using for the work. And so the lamp working just really quenched a huge thirst in needing to be creative and whatever. And now that I'm retired, and now I'm knitting. I'm doing fiber. I'm spinning, I'm knitting, and I seriously want to get into dyeing. And last week I promised I would show you the fiber that I dyed in my, I've got this, see that sort of light coming down? That's not God. I know in a lot of pictures it looks like God, not God. That's just my light. I hope it's okay. But anyway, last week in my Vogue Knitting Live podcast, I said I would show you my fiber that I dyed in my Felicia Lowe class. I'd had a class with Felicia Lowe of Sweet Georgia Yarns, which was amazing. She's really, really good, and she was an excellent teacher. I learned a lot from her. And I think what I learned from her, the vast majority of it will be applicable to dyeing yarn as well. So that was fun. So I will get my fiber now, which I didn't braid it up all pretty and everything. It's still hanging on the hangers. It was drying on, but at least I'll show you. So hold on. Okay. So my hangers. We had two, as part of the class, we got, there was like a class fee, and it covered the fiber that we, and the dye and everything, I presume, that we were using. So the first fiber we were using was a merino bamboo blend, you can see. And the bamboo, since we were using acid dyes, the bamboo did not take the dye. So these white spaces in this fiber are the bamboo. So that's going to be lovely. So I did I don't know if this is showing you very well, but I did sort of a blue going into a red. So when they combined, it kind of got purple, a little bit of purple there. And then I went to the red, and the red went into the yellow. So where they combined, it got kind of orangey, which apparently I'm into these days, if you recall the yarn that I dyed in my class. And then, you know, so those are the colors. So this was the first fiber I dyed. So this will be interesting. I think I definitely will need to do a chain ply on this just to keep the colors the way they were. And then the second one was a superwash BFL. And this one I did in blue with just a little bit of, while the blue was sitting there, I ended up squirting some yellow on it to make it a little bit green. So this is gonna be, this could be a two ply, that would be fine. This kind of fell apart in the heating process in the class because she was using really ad hoc, hot plates and pans and whatever. I mean, this was nothing, you know, this was a conference room set up to do this wet stuff. It was kind of crazy. There was, you know, they put plastic on the floor and stuff. So anyway, my particular yarn ended up sort of falling out of its plastic, and I think of all the yarns, it got the most abuse while it was trying to be heated and everything, but I think it's still a beautiful color. I'm not sure how much of the green ended up showing up. But, you know, it's variegated in colors and stuff, and we shall see. I will definitely be spinning this up at some point, but this is superwash BFL, and we, you know, both of them were superwash because when you're first learning how to dye fiber, I guess you don't want to deal with, you know. So I'm going to have to pre-draft this and, you know, make little nests and things like people do, but it turned out pretty, and I'm pretty happy with it. So this is going to be a beautiful blue. And so I have those were my two fibers that I dyed in my Felicia Lowe class, the dyeing fiber class, I forget its official name, at Vogue Knitting Live on last weekend. And I'm sitting here realizing that I forgot to make myself a tea. I don't have anything to drink. So I'm just going to grab my water from the other room and I'll be right back. Okay, I'm back. So my water is not in a lovely vessel, and so I'm going to have to remember to pause before I drink my drink so that I can cut it out. So you don't see my ugly bottle. Anyway, so I am wearing one of my finished objects. I'm so excited. It just finished drying. In fact, it's probably still a tiny bit damp, so I should be careful with it. Now I gotta move my notebook back from my notes for next week. So this is the Below Zero Scarf and Cowl by Elena Nodal. This is the one I made. I had, right after my podcast, not last podcast, but the podcast before, I had been saying I wanted to work with my hand spun. This is hand spun. The fiber is from Wool Gatherings, and it is 40% merino, 40% camel, and 20% silk. And I am so excited. So I had talked about 2 weeks ago wanting to use my hand spun. And then I had taken the dog for a walk, and it was freezing cold. At that point, it was 17 Fahrenheit, which is like -8 centigrade. And I was like, oh my gosh, I wish I had a warm cowl that I could bring up over my face, and it would be lovely. And that same day, Mary Beth from the Crafty Toads reposted on Instagram a thing saying that Elena Nodal, lovely woman that she is, was giving away a free pattern. And she actually, this is the picture she posted. Well, maybe it was this one, I'm not sure. But she posted this as part of her Instagram. And I'm like, oh my gosh, that's what I want to make. And so I got this pattern. So it does not qualify for the By the Brook cowl. Those of you who have watched before know we're doing a By the Book cowl, which I'll talk about later. Because I just got the pattern. I didn't own the pattern in 2016. But, oh my gosh, it is so amazing. It is still a little damp. I have not worn it outside. But it's been 55 degrees here, so wearing it outside is like a moot point at this point. But they also have a hat. She also has a hat, which I am going to buy the pattern for that hat because I do have more of this left over. I don't know if it's enough for a whole hat, but it's enough for me to give it a try. So I'm going to buy the hat pattern for this that goes with this, which I'm sure is called the Below Zero Hat. And I will be trying to make a hat to match this with the leftover yarn that I have, because that would be amazing. It's not the next thing I'm gonna knit, because I owe Dennis a hat. I have his cashmere. I'm going to be knitting with his cashmere when I figure out what hat it was that I said, oh, let's make this one. I tried to find it today. Apparently, I did not favorite it or do anything like remotely reasonable so that I could find it again. So I have to look again and we have to agree again on a pattern, but I'll find a pattern that Dennis would like. When I was making this pattern, when I started, this starts with a provisional cast on, because this is, you cast it on and you knit around like this. And I wonder if that's my provisional. And then after you're done, you Kitchener it. And it's the first time I've ever done a Kitchener this long. And it's the first time I've ever done a Kitchener where you were trying to replicate purl stitches, because this pattern, I don't know if you can tell, but the middle part of it is checkerboard. So it's knit, knit three, purl three, knit three, purl three, and it alternates. So that this is a lovely checkerboard. The problem with this yarn is it doesn't show the pattern great. And so there's a cable here, and there's a different kind of cable down here. Can you see that? Different kind of cable. So anyway, it's nice and squishy. It's got a lot going on. So when I did the Kitchener, I had to Kitchener using purl, which I had never done before. So this was a new thing for me. That was kind of fun. Did I do a great job? Well, probably not. It was a little hard for me to figure out whether I was supposed to be purling or knitting and, you know, that kind of thing. But in terms of the cowl, I'm very happy with it, and I'm fine with the way it ended up with the Kitchener. When I was casting this on, I cast this on with a crocheted provisional cast on, and I don't do the chain however many and then crochet and then knit into the crochet bump, because I could never figure out what bump to knit into. I'm not a crocheter, so I don't understand that chain in the way that a crocheter should understand it. But and that reminds me, I forgot my crochet blanket. I'm pretending to be a crocheter. But anyway, so the way I do it is I take my needle and I crochet around it, and so I have a loop on my needle, and then I knit into that loop. And so it's a crochet cast on, but it's a different kind of crochet cast on. And as I was doing that a week and a half ago, because I cast this on about a week and a half ago, I thought, oh, I should talk about, in my podcast, I should talk about, you know, how I do a crochet cast on for a provisional cast on. And, you know, talk about it because, you know, I would like to add value to the podcast. And, you know, if you aren't familiar with that crochet cast on, to, you know, I've learned a lot from other people's podcasts. And, you know, it would be lovely if this was, you know, a new thing to you. So I thought about it, but I didn't mention it in my last podcast. And boy, am I glad I didn't. Because this podcast, I'd have to be telling you about how do you pick out and cut every single friggin' stitch. I have no idea what I did. But that whole zip it off and put it on a needle, that was not what was happening. OMG. I had to literally pick every stitch. Every stitch was like twisted in my waist harness. Like, I have no idea what I did, but it was a complete and utter failure. I'm like, oh my God, thank God I did not go into like all this detail about, oh, this is how I do a provisional cast on. Oh my gosh. Luckily, there's only 60 stitches. I had to pick out 60 stitches. I had my little scissors. I was terrified. I'm like, oh my gosh, am I just cutting my, you know, like my waist yarn? Luckily, it was completely different color and it was easy to find. But, oh, I had to snip and pick 60 stitches. I'm like, oh my gosh, how did this happen? I have no idea. I'm going to have to do a little practice swatch. I'm gonna have to because I have no idea what happened, but I'm like, oh, thank God I did not like go on and on about, oh, this is how I do a provisional against one. then I'm gonna anyway. So I had a little trouble with my provisional cast on. And luckily I did not train anyone to do it wrong. Keep my information to myself because apparently, I'm an intermediate knitter. I think of myself as kind of an intermediate knitter. You know, beginning to intermediate, but you know, I'm getting in the middle. I feel like I'm getting in the middle of intermediate, which doesn't make me feel that confident that I have a lot to teach anybody. And after that thought, like, oh, I'll just show them how I do my provisional cast. God. I'm so glad I didn't do that. But I have no idea what I did wrong because it has actually worked in the past, but not this time. Oh my gosh. But anyway, I'm really happy with this cowl, and I'm very excited, and I'm hoping that I have enough yarn left over, and I hope it gets cold so I can wear it, but I hope I have enough yarn left over so I can do the hat, because that'll be fun to have the matching hat. It is a little weird to have the stripes go on, this way, but oh well. But this is a finished object, but I have another finished object. Look what I made! I made a Fair Isle hat! Oh my gosh! Doing Fair Isle was on my list of goals for 2017. And look at this. It's January 22nd, I think. Whatever I said in the beginning, because I just called Naz Dennis and he told me. January 20. Yeah, 22nd. Look what I did. This is called the Double Braid Sampler Hat by Susan B. Anderson. And I am not sure whether or not it's available in Ravelry, to tell you the truth. Now you can see I kept the main color as the main, as the background color throughout the whole thing. But you can see otherwise it's the same. But I wanted that purple to show. The purple is yarn that I dyed at the Neighborhood Fiber Company. But as I was saying, I couldn't find this pattern in Ravelry. Maybe you can. Maybe it is available. But I thought maybe it was just pattern that she gives to her students, because I took this class from Susan and this is what she gave us. She actually gave us another pattern which had more than two colors, but this was the one she taught because it has the two Latvian braids, one going each way, and then just different ways to do beginner Fair Isle, because I had never done it before, so I was so glad to have this. And here with the Fair Isle is where we practiced our capturing our floats. So I'm pretty happy with that it turned out. I do not think I have any tension issues. I will show you the inside of my hat. I'm not afraid. So this is the inside of my hat. This is where the floats were getting caught here. And I'm really excited about this hat. It fits me great, except I fixed my hair and I am not going to put it on. I've got this little head, so you can see it. But the pattern has a pom-pom, and this just dried today. So just finished drying today. I'm still thinking about the pom-pom. This head is smaller than mine, so it covers up her eyes. I am still thinking about the pom-pom. I actually have pom-pom makers back in those blue shelves back there. So I may decide to make a pom-pom. I do not have a hat with a pom-pom. I've never used those pom-pom makers. I did make my granddaughter a hat with a pom-pom when she was like 3 months old. And it was adorable. I think it needs a pom-pom. I think I'm gonna do the pom-pom, but I haven't done it yet. So anyway, so that's my second finished object. And like I said, this is the purple is my hand-dyed yarn that I dyed in my class from Neighborhood Fiber Arts in Baltimore. And the natural color is Wool of the Andes Worsted Weight in the color Natural. And I had that from my Christmas stuff. And so I just used it and it turned out great. And I'm so excited. I did it. So I did buy, I showed you last podcast, I did buy some yarn to make a bobble hat. And I do plan on making a bobble hat at some point. So, works in progress. I probably should have waited. There was no reason to frog these socks without showing them to you before I frog them. But a few days ago, I started to get nervous because I'm really interested in participating in quite a few, I'm trying to get my Lolo bar. I forgot to show you this last time. I got plain Jane Lolo bar. I'm allergic to scents. So my hands were sitting here. So I'm multitasking. So anyway, I am interested in participating in the Naughty Knitwits are having a Sock of the Month Cal. And the rules for that are basically you have to knit a sock within the month. So you have to start it January 1st or after, and you have to finish it January 31st or before. And Michelle's so funny. In the last podcast, Naughty Knitwits podcast, she was yelling at Leslie because Leslie had started her February socks and it's not February yet. So she's being very strict about the time frames. So I wanted to make a January sock because I wanted to participate in the Naughty Knitwits knit along. I'm very interested in Kristen of Woolen Vine and the Yarngasm podcast. I'm interested in her box of socks this year. I did not do it last year. And I'm interested if I can manage it to also put my socks in the Grocery Girls knit along because they're doing a monthly knit along, but your socks have to have the month itself as part of its theme. So I may need some help with that. But anyway, the other knit along that I had been hoping to participate in is the I forget what it's called. The Wonders of the World knit along, where every month is a different continent. And Connie of Chili Knits is participating in this. Her continent is, of course, South America. She's from Chile. And but that her continent is until June. The first continent was Australia, New Zealand in January. And I have some beautiful yarn from Megan that I got in a swap from New Zealand, and I thought I would use that and find a sock pattern that I could use. And I tried two sock patterns. I tried the Fine and Dandy sock pattern, and I tried the Something Flames sock pattern. Both of them were by Australian designers. And the Fine and Dandy did not work for me. That would be the second time I tried it and it didn't work for me. I do two at a time. Apparently there's a video on how to do it, but by the time I knew that, Connie told me that because she was doing them two at a time. By the time I knew that, I had already taken them apart and started the other one, which I'm putting the name of the pattern down here because I don't remember something about flames or something. And that pattern was very interesting because, and I showed you this last podcast, because it had a picot cast on, which was really beautiful. I loved it. I thought it was wonderful, and I thought it was great, except it did not. I couldn't get it on my foot. So that was it. So this was like Thursday, maybe it was Tuesday, Monday or Tuesday, maybe. I'm not sure exactly when, but finally I just said, you know what? I need a January sock. I need a January sock for a lot of reasons. I want to be in the Naughty Knitwits podcast. I want to be in the, you know, I need to get going. So I'm afraid that I am not participating in the Wonders of the World this month because I could not come up with a sock pattern that would work for me by somebody in Australia. And I'm sure only because I'm not that familiar. And I promise I will go back. I will look in the thread to figure out who qualifies as designers, you know, who would have qualified for this. But meanwhile, I was just like, forget it. I need to go. I need a sock for January. So I went back to my, I did the Mercury socks by Kim McKenzie as my Christmas Eve cast on for Danny, you know, with Danny of the Little Bobbins. And I did made beautiful socks with the yarn from Once Upon a Corgi, Gabigail. Beautiful. And those were lovely, and I love them. I enjoyed knitting them. I enjoyed wearing them. So I said, forget all this other stuff I'm doing. I am going to make Mercury socks. And I am just at the point, I'm going to put Fish Lips Kiss Heels in these. And if you're familiar with that pattern, although it's a dollar, I shouldn't tell you too much, but she has you do stockinette for a while before you start the heel so you get a nice fit. I have started the stockinette on the heel, so I'm getting ready to put the heel in these. And this yarn is yarn that I bought in at Vogue Knitting Live. And I have one of the yarns from these people is going to be in the as a giveaway. But this is Indie Steps Good For You. And I think Good For You is the name of the yarn company, and Indie Steps may be the name of the base. But I could be wrong. Anyway, you can see what it is. You can decide what it is. It says Colors Inspired by Home, and they are from Indianapolis, Indiana. And this color is called Allisonville Green, which is funny. So Allisonville is probably a local town very near Indianapolis because it says Colors Inspired by Home. But this yarn is 40% superwash merino, 40% baby llama, and 20% nylon. I think this is going to be so warm, and I don't know if you can see it because, you know, this is a phone and not one of those cameras that you can get a real close-up of. This yarn has an amazing halo. It is so soft to work with. It is so much fun to knit. I'm really, really enjoying it. And I have one of our giveaways for our knit-alongs is the same yarn, only in the purple, which is also beautiful. It was hard to decide, but I wanted something really bright. Okay, so I need your help. For this to qualify for the Grocery Girls knit-along, it has to have some reference to January. So these are Mercury socks. Allisonville Green is the color. I bought the yarn in January. I bought it at Vogue Knitting Live. It's sort of a souvenir, January souvenir, so that might work. I don't know. Is Mercury aligned with Mars in January or something weird like that? Some astrological thing with Mercury that might work for this? I'll work on it. But if you have any ideas about how these socks could be particularly associated with January, other than the fact that I'm actually knitting them in January and will be wearing them in January when I finish them, let me know, because I would appreciate it. But I'm really enjoying these. Oh, they're so soft, and whoever wins that yarn is going to love it if you're a sock knitter. I can tell you that right now, because gorgeous. And with 40% baby llama, those are going to be extremely warm socks. So I hope somebody in the cold places wins that yarn. Or has a friend in cold places. If they win the yarn and they live in Florida, maybe they have somebody up north who they can knit something for. Because this is going to be Very, very, very warm socks. Let me tell you. I'm so excited. So, the other thing that I have been working on is my Find Your Fade. And I'll tell you the truth. I was losing my fade. Two times ago when I podcast, I was here. This is where I was. And the week before the last podcast, I took this project to Vogue Knitting Live, but I did not knit on it. I worked on my hat that I got the first class that I was there, and I worked on my socks that I finished last week. I didn't work on my fade. And my fade starts with a Tosh Merino light. And the color of that part is Great Gray Owl. And then, And the second color I have, it's kind of hard to see in this. It's a little bit lilac-y, mauve-y, whatever. This yarn is called From Two Guys Yarn. It's the Bachelor Collection. And the colorway of that is called Spring Sky. And this is a beautiful yarn. This gray yarn I used in my Across the Pond shawl that I made, Mina Phillips pattern. And this Two Guys yarn I put in a Because I Love You shawl that I made for my mother last year for Mother's Day. And that was beautiful. And so that's where that yarn is. And I only have a tiny bit. I had a little bit of the gray left, but I put it in my blanket. And I have a tiny little bit of the purple left, and that will go in my blanket, and that will be it. My third color, so I was kind of losing my steam on the Find Your Fade. And then, because I hadn't worked on it for over a week. And then Danny of Little Bobbins had her podcast, which I watch almost immediately when it comes on. And she was doing her Find Your Fade, and she was showing and going on and on how wonderful it was to knit and how beautiful. And I realized, you know, I was like, well, I was right here. I had just started the lace on the second color, and I thought, let me just get to the third color and, you know, see how I feel. And as soon as I put the third color in, you know, it really came to life. So I'm very excited. So the third color is Malabrigo sock yarn in the Archangel colorway. So this is the color I'm using now. That's what's going on now. And my next color will be this. So this is Highland Handmaids in the Red Maple sock base, which is merino and bamboo. I'm not sure the percentages. And the color is called Sour Grapes. And you can see the purple and how it will kind of match. So watching Danny helped me find my fade again. So I was pretty happy with that. And, you know, for the most part, I mean, it's a very easy to knit pattern. Lots of it is garter stitch, and I'll say this is the front, but it doesn't matter quite so much. And so I'm really happy with it. I was a little concerned because these first two yarns I'm using are merino singles, and they're really soft and kind of shiny. I think this one even has some silk in it. And then the Malabrigo sock is 100% merino. It's not a single. It's a sock yarn, although I've never used it for socks, so I don't know. So I was a little concerned about the difference in texture, but I feel fine with it now as I'm knitting it. It may be a little weird when I'm wearing it. I don't know. It's hard to know. And then my next yarn has bamboo in it, which is going to make it feel silky like the other ones. So I have a mix of bases that I'm using, so I'm happy, you know, I think it'll be fine. So I'm working on my find my fade, and of course, I mean, I can't believe any of you haven't heard of this. Is like the big thing, internet sensation in the knitting world, but this is the Find Your Fade by Andrea Mowry. So I thank you, Danny. I found my fade once again, thanks to you. So that was fun. So, oh, there they are, under. I have my son's mittens here to show you. They turned out really great. These were his Christmas present. He got to pick his Christmas present this year. Everybody gets to pick a big present. He didn't want a sweater. I appreciated him saying that because, I mean, I can't imagine knitting him a sweater and then either he feels guilty and wears it when he doesn't want to, or I feel, or he doesn't wear it and that feels bad. So anyway, he said he would like some really, really warm mittens. And so I made him these. These are the Norwegian Fisherman's Mittens by Eva Skullbru Eriksson. Putting it there. And they are super warm. He wore them. We actually had a snow since Christmas, and he wore them, and they were super warm. But the reason I have them back is, when I made them, that bind-off I did on these mittens is too tight. I thought I was doing a stretchy bind-off, but I guess the stretchy bind-off, you're supposed to knit through the back of the loop, and I was knitting through the front. And I made a very tight bind-off. And I knew the bind-off was tight. And instead of just taking it out and binding it off again in a way that was looser because I knew it was too tight, it was getting close to Christmas. That's my only excuse. But the little voice in my head said, these are too tight. You gotta fix them. That voice. That voice. So I did not weave in the end before I gave it to him so that it would be easier to take it out if it didn't fit him. But my son is a lovely, accommodating man, and he was able to put them on. So he said, you know, he said, no, they're fine, Mom. So I just opened the ends and I left. I have tiny hands and I can barely get them in there. So this past visit with my three-year-old granddaughter, be careful what you say in front of a three-year-old, she said, Daddy's mitten is too tight. I said, oh, really? Did he have trouble with it in the snow? Oh, yeah, it was too tight in the snow, Nana. So when I brought her home, I said to Allison, was Jason's mitten too tight? Well, it was, one of them was a little tight. So he came home from work. We were there. The way it works is we go on Tuesday night and we have dinner at their house and Jason comes home and we get to see him. And then we bring out Isabel to our house and she stays overnight with us. We spend the day on Wednesday with her and then take her home. So Jason came home from work and I said to him, oh, so the mittens really are a little too tight. And he looks at Alice and says, ah, you ratted me out. She said, I didn't do it. I said, Isabel told me. He said, well, you know, the one is a little tight. And you can see, it's hard to tell, but, you know, one of them is slightly, but they're both tight. I said, give them to me. I can fix them. It's easy to fix. I'll fix them. So I got these last, well, and then I left them, so I picked them up on Wednesday. So I got them Wednesday. I haven't fixed them yet. But I will fix them tomorrow. So he will have mittens that are not too tight. I'm going to fix both of them. He said only the right one needs to be fixed. They both need to be fixed. I'll fix them both. I'll make a nice stretchy and it'll be easy. It won't take too long. But you never did get to see them. I don't think. Maybe you did. But this is what they look like finished. And they are where he loved them, except for the one wrist rubbed. But he said they were very warm and they were wonderful for shoveling, which is what he wanted. And so that's good. So I will be fixing this bind off and replacing it with something stretchier, and then they will be good to go. So, I knew they were too tight. I was just lazy. I should have just, I was just lazy. That voice said they're too tight. And I knew it. Oh, I'll just not weave in the end. And then if he says they're too tight, I can fix them. He's not going to say. He's going to say, Mom, they're great. I know that. He's a, you know, he's that kind of guy. Which you appreciate on one hand because he's not a complainer. And on the other hand, you're like, you know, but it's my own fault. I knew they were too tight. I didn't need him to tell me. That voice was telling me they're too tight. So anyway, so that's another finished object / work in progress because I have to finish it up. So the things I'm going to be working on next, I got that beautiful cashmere at Knitting Live to make Dennis a hat. So that will be next. He definitely will get the hat before I make the hat to match this. And I am planning on picking up his sweater and start working on that again. I need a quiet couple of hours to figure out what I did, because I did like one side of the front of the sweater, and I need to figure out what I did so I can do the other side of the front of the sweater to match. Because the pattern, I felt like I was doing a lot of interpretation, and I need to make sure that I interpret it the same way as I did the, you know, for the left side as I did for the right side. So it'll take a little mental energy, but I do want to work on his sweater. I do. I really do. It's beautiful yarn. It's that New Zealand yarn that has possum in it. Ah, it's delicious. So the other thing that's on my list of things I'm going to do is I've decided I'm going to participate in the Snow Melt Mystery Knit Along with Helen Stewart. That pattern is you can pre-order it tomorrow. And I have bought several patterns to do mystery knit alongs. As you might recall, I bought the pattern for the building block because I was thinking I was going to do the building block, and then I bailed after the first clue came out because I wasn't, you know, I didn't think I was going to like it. In the end, I did like it. I've seen several that I really love. Rebecca of the Mean Girls podcast and Stephanie of the Mean Girls podcast, they both made beautiful building blocks. So I was, you know, a little sorry I didn't do it. But to tell you the truth, his knit along does not come at a good time because his does it in October when I'm busy doing Christmas knitting. So that's my story, and I'm sticking to it. But anyway, so I've decided I'm going to do this mystery knit along of the snow. It's called the Snow Melt Shawl. I love Helen Stewart shawls. I did her Shawl Society. I made 3 out of the 6 shawls. Maybe I made 4. 3 or 4 out of the 6 shawls. And and I love her aesthetic. I own a couple other patterns of hers that I haven't knit yet. So I'm very confident that I'm going to like her pattern and be happy making it. And I've decided I'm going to use my, I made a gradient, 3 skeins of single, merino single gradient when I did my dyeing at the Neighborhood Fiber Company. I keep talking about that. I keep using my yarn. I love, you know, it's so exciting to me to be able to use that yarn I dyed. And of course, I was such a wool pig. I shouldn't say that. I was so enthusiastic that I made lots and lots of yarn. So I have lots of yarn I dyed. I don't know why I say wool pig, because I really hate that term. Anyway, so I will show you the yarn that I'm intending to make my mystery calendar, but it's over there and I have to get up. It's not actually that easy to get up from this chair. So these are the skeins that I dyed. This is the darker. So this is the gradient set. And this is a beautiful soft singles, which are the yarns she uses in her sample are singles. And she uses a gradient, although it's very different than this. But I'm hoping this will work. With a mystery shawl, Of course, if you can look at the shawl, you can decide which one is color A, which one is color B, which one is color C. And so it'll be a little hard when I don't know what it's going to look like to decide which is A, B, and C. Although there's lace work with A. I think she mentioned that. But her shawls typically start at the top, you know, with like a, so her version of a garter tab, and then move out so that when you put the shawl on to wear it like a scarf, this is color A will be what's right around your neck to start, and color C will be the border and the last part of it. So I guess I need to decide which color do I want around my neck and which color do I want on the border and decide that way. But anyway, these are the colors that I'm thinking. I'm going to do my snow melt and mystery knit along with, and that starts on February 2nd. So I will actually be podcasting before that starts, but anyway, so I decided to do that. The other thing that I want to do fairly soon is we are going to be on vacation, going on a nice, lovely, special vacation at the very end of March. We'll be gone for several weeks in April. And I'm thinking that I would like to make a t-shirt for that trip out of that beautiful silk that I bought at Vogue Knitting Live. And I will show you that again. Hold on. Our vacation will be in warm climates, so I can use a t-shirt. But this is the yarn that I got. It's a silk noil, 100% silk, which will make a beautiful t-shirt slash lovely sweater. And so I'm on the lookout for a t-shirt that will look good in this silk fingering. Do you have any suggestions? I would love to look at your suggestions. I do have one t-shirt that I'm thinking about in a book that I have, which would mean that I would be, you know, qualify for my Buy the Book Cal, which even though I can't actually qualify. Sadie Ruin of the Yarnivore podcast. She's also having a Buy the Book Cal where it has to be an actual book. My knit along that I'm doing with Sharon of the Moms with Yarn podcast, it just has to be a pattern that you owned in 2016. So it could be a single pattern. But Sadie's is and the Yarn of Our podcast, and I forget who she's doing it with, that it needs to actually be in a book. But I have a t-shirt in an actual book that I'm thinking about using, and I will think about that more and show it to you next week. But this is on my list of things that I want to do. Another thing that I wanted to do is I had bought this Knitter's Keeper at Vogue Knitting Live. It was quite pricey, $40. And it's a slap bracelet, which means that it's got, you know, memory metal inside of it, and this magnetic plate. And then it has all kinds of metal accessories that sit on this magnetic plate. Well, I decided to use it while I was working on my cowl, because of the cables, and I was using a cable needle. I'm so happy with this. So the cable needle is metal. Of course, it sits on here. And I discovered that I couldn't use that cable needle, to tell you the truth. It was so slippery that it was completely useless to me. It was very handy because it sat right here so I could find it. But when I was actually trying to use it, too slippery. It just slipped right out. I went back to my plastic cable needle that I got at Joann's that worked great. So that was a little bit disappointing. It may have been a little small, but it was, you know, they had two sizes. I was using the biggest one, so that was a little disappointing. But I did discover that I don't mind it on my wrist, and so I was, you know, happy to use it like that. So I am going to be on the lookout for the little row counter that will sit on here, and maybe that will work for me. And I haven't tried to use, like, the darning needle, and the other things that are in here are darning needles and metal stitch markers, large stitch markers, bent tip tapestry needle, open stitch markers, and small stitch markers. So basically, it's a tapestry needle, two cable needles that are very slippery, and a tapestry needle. So that was a little disappointing because I was kind of excited to use it for my cabling, but it was very slippery. And I was, you know, I mean, I was doing all kinds of shenanigans trying to figure out how to, you know, so it wouldn't fall out. And then I thought, you know what, I don't have to do this with my plastic cable needle, and I'll just keep it in my mouth like I have been. So that's a tiny little, you know, follow up on my knitter's keep, as it's called. It comes in a fancy box, which I happen to leave up here when I knit it. So it comes in this fancy box. I got the blue one. So the cable needle was a little disappointing. So FYI, in case you were wondering. So I did want to talk a little bit about the knit alongs. I didn't have anything, nothing today qualified for our knit alongs. I didn't make anything tiny this week, but I looked up a few, recipes, a few patterns that I am planning on making. And I just want to say that the Flame and Fiber Knit Tiny Things Knit Along, or Tiny Things Knit Along, is sort of an all-year knit along. I plan to do prize drawings every quarter or so. But as far as I can tell, anything that qualifies for this tiny thing knit along in our group also qualifies for the Stuff It knit along in the Naughty Knitwits group. They, you know, because Michelle has said, you know, when she listed things that qualify, she did list tiny little mittens and things like that. So they don't have to actually be stuffed. They just have to be small knitted things that are kind of ornaments and, you know, little tiny things. So just letting you know that you can double dip in the Naughty Knitwits Stuff It knit along, which is also a year long knit along. If you make something that qualifies, you might as well double dip. That's what I say. And so basically anything that's tiny, and baby booties count, but that's it. You know, no, you know, even a baby sweater isn't tiny enough. I'm talking about tiny, tiny. But those tiny little sweaters that are like an ornament, they count. And, you know, anything that's like an ornament or a tiny little toy, a bird of happiness, or tiny little mochi mochis, anything, crochet is fine, needle felting is fine, you know, anything that's tiny and kind of an ornament or some little tiny thing will work. The baby booties are a bit of a stretch. Because I'm not thinking of things that are very practical, but mostly ornaments and decorations and things like that. So, and I guess baby booties may not qualify for the Naughty Knitwits. I'm not sure. But the other things do. Tiny little stockings that you hang on your tree, or little sweaters, or little stuffed animals. Those little elves that, oh, they're so adorable. Leslie made some of those elves on the Naughty Knitwits. Oh, they're so cute. I don't have that pattern, but I may end up getting it in the end. But I have lots of little patterns I've collected to make little tiny things. So I will be making more tiny things. I just have to make sure I have the right yarns and things. And so that's one knit along. And there's the thread. It's Chatter and Finished Objects together, because it's all going to be together. And then we're going to draw prizes. And the second knit along that is running in our group is the By the Book knit along, which we're doing with the Moms with Yarn podcast. And Sharon at the Moms with Yarn podcast has a thread in her group. We have a finished objects thread in our group, plus a chatter thread. And there will be a chatter thread prize and a finished object prize in our group. And definitely double dip. If you're a member of Sharon's group, go and post your projects over there. There's no reason not to double dip. And so this By the Book knit along, I'm also thinking of it as the support your local Ravelry library. And that is, if you owned the pattern at the end of 2016, in other words, if you're starting a and you started the project in 2017, so basically you're knitting a project from a pattern that you already owned. That's the concept. Knit from your library instead of buying a new pattern to make your project. That's it. That's the premise. And works in progress are eligible because, you know, we want to finish those. So I want to support that. And this, you know, the Dennis's sweater. Same thing. Same kind of thing. So there is a finished objects thread. There's a bunch of beautiful things there. So go check them out and be sure and double dip. Certainly double dip into Sharon's group, the Moms with Yarn. She has a thread too. So be sure and check out her podcast and her thread, and you'll probably enjoy that. So that's about it. The one thing I did want to tell you, and I don't have my blanket with me to show you, but I showed you on other podcasts. I have been thinking about my crochet blanket, and I'm going to go get it. I'll be right back. So I'm back. I guess I'm not sure what I want to say about this blanket. Because I was thinking, when I was first or second week of doing this blanket, I showed you, you know, my crochet skills. Not so good. Not so good. Oh, but see, I'm coming here. And I've been thinking about this blanket. I haven't worked on it in 2 weeks. And part of it is because, yeah, it's a mess. Part of it is because that little voice, you got to start listening to that little voice telling you. You know, when I first showed you this lump on the one side, this is the, I think this is the original side. One side is this side. That little lump, I said, you know, it didn't bother me. And it was true. But look at that. I just started another lump. What the heck? But then 2 weeks ago on my podcast, I, you know, realized the other side is a mess too. Look what I'm doing on the other side. And the more I thought about it, the more I realized, I mean, it's one thing when you're brand new and you do this little mistake and then you learn from your mistake and you do better. But look at that. I'm doing it again. I can do better than this. I can do better than this. And I'm going to have this blanket for a really long time. And frankly, I haven't gotten that far that I shouldn't just go back. So I'm going to pull this out. And I'm going to pull it all the way out to here. Because this is where I go wrong, right here. I start stretching out. And anyway, my plan is to rip out the majority of this back to here, I guess. Which is really 1, 2, 3. Oh, wrong side. So I'm going to rip out to here. So that's 1, 2, 3, like 3. So I'm going to rip it out to here. I'm going to ball this all up and I'm going to recrochet that because it's crazy. That's, you know, it would be one thing if I had just one little thing and then that was it. But look, You can see that, you know, I mean, I'm doing it again. I need to pay attention. It's not that hard. It's obviously just, you know, I need to pay attention. I mean, look at that. You can't even see because it's so bendy. So, anyway, I just wanted to let you know I haven't given up on my blanket because this is full of beautiful yarn. I started this yarn with a beautiful yarn that I got from Sarah, and the yarns I got from Megan, I got from lovely people. And I have more. I have that beautiful yarn I got from Linda, and I don't want to put it into this blanket. I want to put it into a blanket that is, you know, I mean, don't get me wrong. I'm going to make mistakes. It's not going to be perfect, but there is no reason. There is no reason in the world for me to keep going on this the way it is, because that's crazy. I can do better than that. So that's what I'm going to do. That first little bump, it didn't bother me. I was quite confident it wasn't bothering me, and I think it wasn't because I kept going and it didn't bother me, but once I realized what I kept doing and how bad it was, I mean, it just kept getting worse and worse. Look at that. I mean, I just said, oh, I'm not going to do that anymore. I did good for a while, and then what the heck is that? So I'm not doing that anymore. Anyway, so that's the plan. I'm going to tear it back to here, where I started going wrong the first time, and that should straighten out everything on the other side too, because the other side is better for longer. So that should be fine. And then I'm going to pay much closer attention to the edges of my blanket. There's no reason to do this. So anyway, that's my plan. That's the update on my blanket. So I've decided I'm going to tear it out down to here and try to do a better job. It won't be perfect. This is my first time ever crocheting. So I was giving myself a break for a while till I totally start jacking it up again. It's ridiculous. I can do better. I need to learn. But it doesn't mean I need to end up with a crappy blanket when I'm done. So anyway, that's my plan. Just a little update on my blanket. And a little advice to pay attention to that voice in your head. I knew those mittens were too tight. Why didn't I fix them? I could have just fixed them. He could have had them. It wouldn't be all this big, you know, not that it was big. It wasn't a big deal. He was like, why did you say something? Allison said, it wasn't me. It was Isabel. You got to be very careful what you say in front of Isabel. I can't even remember what it was. We were in the car and I said something. Oh, wasn't that nice, Dappy? She calls Dennis Dappy. Wasn't that nice, Dappy? She was in the car with us and said, he's like, it was okay. I'm like, wasn't that nice, Dappy? Little ears. He's like, oh yeah, it was lovely. You gotta be careful with her because, yeah, so that was pretty funny. Daddy's mittens are too tight. I'm like, okay, Bunkin. Nana can fix them. Just like I have to fix her, her monkey. Excuse my very close look. I have to fix her monkey. I made this monkey for her. I gave this to her the first day I met her. She was a premature baby. She came. She was due at the end of September, and we had a shower for Allison on the 24th of August. She was due on September 27th. We had a shower on the 24th of August, and I did not have this done for the shower. She was born on the 26th of August. I had it done by the time I got to the hospital and said, hey, baby, I'm Nana, and here's your little monkey. There's your monkey. I was a very new, pretty new knitter then, so he's pretty cute, but I'd only been knitting for 6 months when she was born. Anyway, I have to fix that and the mittens. That's my task for the next couple days, and I'm tearing out my blanket tonight, and I think I'm going to rewatch the video from Attic 24. I'm using the tutorial from Attic 24, the Corner of Craft. podcast. I will rewatch her videos on how to do the edges, because she does say how to do them. I was just not paying that much attention, so that I don't have this problem anymore. And I'm going to restart, because I want to honor the beautiful yarns I have, and I'm so happy to have them. And I'm not that far. It is going to be a huge, big, giant blanket. So I need to tear it out now and do better. So that's my plan. So anyway, I guess that's it. I'm not sure what else I need to talk about. Let me check. I made some notes. Things to talk about. Well, I did want to mention the time. These podcasts are very long, and I hope that's okay. I did want to mention stash management a little bit. I haven't mentioned it for the last few episodes, and I'm a little sorry I named it stash management, because I was listening to the Shiny Bees podcast. It's an audio podcast with Jo. She's British and lovely and funny. And she was talking about stash appreciation. And Helen Stewart of Curious Handmade referenced Jo's podcast and was also talking about stash appreciation. And the way they were talking about it made me really think about my stash, because I was trying to do some kind of stash management, you know, sort of with some vague idea of, you know, having less stash at the end of the year than the beginning of the year, keeping track of what came in and what came out. And they were talking about stash appreciation and the fact that they loved their stash and their stash made them happy. And, you know, why they sort of let this guilt sort of from the outside come in. And it really got me thinking, and, you know, the fact of the matter, and they were talking about being yarn collectors. And I'm certainly a collector of things. When I start a hobby, I definitely like to acquire the ingredients and the tools and the information. I have two Rubbermaid bins full of poker books in the basement, because I was a poker player for 5 years. That was my hobby, and I played a lot of poker. I played so much poker that I filed my taxes as a professional poker player for my second job. I played a lot of poker. And I studied. You know, you want to be a good poker player, you got to study. So I have two Rubbermaid bins of books, of poker books in the basement. Poker strategy changes. I should probably just recycle those books. I don't think those books are going to help anybody, certainly not me. But they're in the basement for the moment. When I started lamp working, I mean, I have a beautiful collection of glass to make lamp work beads, and I will not need to buy glass for a very long time. And I'm fine with that. It's beautiful glass, and I love it, and I enjoy having it. It's funny, you know, I feel better when my, you know, when we buy milk and my milk container's full. I don't like it when my milk container only has that much milk. Even though if it's enough milk for me for today and I can buy milk tomorrow, something is very satisfying about having enough. I don't know if that makes sense. But so when they were started talking about stash appreciation and being a yarn collector, I realized that my problem, my mental or psychological problem with my stash is not actually a problem with my stash. I love my stash. I love the yarn. I love buying it. I love touching it. I love knitting it. You know, I'm very happy with my yarn. My problem is that I have been overspending. My problem isn't that I'm bringing yarn into my house and so my bins are filling up. That doesn't bother me. The problem is I'm spending too much money. I've been overspending my allowance. I've been very lucky, because I was a very lucky, emphasis on lucky, poker player. And so I tried to be a skilled poker player, but the fact is I was very lucky. And so I ended up with money so that, you know, 8 years later, I'm still spending my poker winnings on my hobbies. But that money is going down fast. And it has gone down really fast since I started knitting. Because at least with my lamp working, I started making money selling my beads. And so that helped pay for the glass and everything. And I'm not making any money as a knitter. So anyway, I realized that my problem was that I was overspending my allowance by a lot every year that I was knitting. And that's what's bothering me. It's not the fact of owning yarn. It's the fact that I'm spending more money than I have. My income, i.e. my allowance, is smaller than the amount of money I've been spending. And so once I sort of realized that, that's the problem. The problem isn't that I have stash. The result of my problem spending too much money is, you know, I mean, they're very associated. Don't misunderstand me. I recognize that they're associated. But it's not the actual owning the yarn that's the problem. The problem is I'm spending too much money. So rather than focusing on how much yarn is in and how much yarn is out for my stash management, I'm not actually going to be doing stash management. I'm going to be doing allowance management, i.e. I'm going to be living within the bounds of my allowance this year. It'll help that in my conversation with Dennis, we both realized that maybe our allowances aren't quite enough, and maybe I'll get a little bigger allowance, and that'll help. But my plan this year is to live within my allowance. It's not to worry about how much yarn I buy and that kind of thing. And, you know, it's basically, I'm going to manage my budget. That's what I'm going to do. So it will manage my stash, but, you know, the secondary effect of that will be managing my stash. Obviously, I'm not going to be, if I'm staying within my allowance, I'm not going to be buying as much yarn as I have been. I didn't even talk about my goodies. I don't have any yarn goodies, but my one goodie is, I forgot to look up who gave me the suggestion. I got a lovely suggestion from one of our group who, two podcasts ago when I was talking about my minis, suggested, and I will put her name, thank you so much. I'm so sorry, I should have looked it up. Suggested this book to me. So I bought this book on Amazon. It was only $8.50 or something on Amazon Prime. So, you know, with the cost of patterns, it's really a bargain. So, and it's a lark book all about how to use up your minis. And they're, I said, let me look at some of the patterns and see if there are any that I want to talk about. And I ended up with a gazillion patterns, which is a little bit ridiculous, but there are some really pretty things. This is slouchier than I like, so I may make some version of that that's not quite so slouchy. But, you know, I'm trying to do Fair Isle, and that would be really sweet for the kids, my granddaughters. I don't know that I would wear it, but the granddaughters might wear it. But this is a beautiful scarf. I don't know if you can tell. This is called the Intersection Color Study in Blue. But I don't know if you can tell from this picture, but this is knit this way, and this is knit this way. So it's like all different geometry involved in that scarf that is really amazing, that I really liked. And, you know, I may do something with that that doesn't even involve minis. And then a cowl, which was cute. And socks, a little idea for socks and how to do sock minis. I mean, I don't need a book to tell me how to make stripes in a sock, but that was kind of fun. But this, it may be my favorite one. This is a beautiful sweater. And my minis are big enough that I could do something like this. Although this uses 7 minis. I don't know if I have 7 that all kind of go together. But this is made out of orange flower merino singles. I love orange flower yarn. I have my amulet shawl that I've worn on this podcast is made out of orange flower yarn, and it's so gorgeous. Of course, this is merino singles, and what mine was had silk in it and stuff. But anyway, I think that's beautiful. So, and these are adorable. Do people really use these? If they do, I don't know. But Linda gave me some tiny little minis from No Makers that are adorable. I bet these would be cute with those. So anyway, thank you so much for the suggestion of this book. It's a bargain at $8. There are lots. I didn't even show you all the ones that I have marked. Because so this is my goodies. I did not buy any yarn. I bought enough yarn at Vogue Knitting Live to last me for a very long time. So anyway, so my stash management is definitely more going to, is not going to be stash management. It's going to be sticking in my budget. And that's it. So, you know, I don't really spend my allowance for very much other than yarn and my hobby here. I buy my clothes since I retired. I buy the vast majority of my clothes at the Goodwill. Hey, I don't really, you know, I have a lot of nice clothes that, the only problem is I have actually been losing weight, which is not a problem. It's a good thing. But that means that my clothes from when I was working are starting to not fit me great. So I may need to spend some of my allowance on actual clothes that don't come from the Goodwill. Although I've gotten some really great stuff from the Goodwill, so maybe I'll be lucky and it'll be fine. But anyway, so my stash management is actually going to be allowance management, and we'll see how that works. But so far I'm fine, because my Vogue Knitting Live is going to be paid, my purchases that aren't covered by my birthday will be paid for in January and February, so that'll be good, it'll be fine. And I am planning on going to the Maryland Sheep and Wool Show, which is only a few hours away from me. I'm in southeastern Pennsylvania. But I'm not expecting to buy any yarn before that. A thing here or there. Except that I signed up for this yarn club called A Good Yarn. I followed a link in an email. Big mistake. But it was $10 plus $4 shipping for, you get a skein of, full-size skein of yarn and a pattern and a little tchotchke. I'm supposed to get one any day. I will see what I think of it. You can cancel it whenever you want. But $14, I love a surprise in the mail. So that's coming. But other than that, and I think that's got to be everything. So please join the knit-alongs, buy the book, knit-along with the Moms with Yarn podcast. If you've owned the pattern before January 1st and you started it January 1st or later, then please enter. And if you're making a tiny thing, an ornament, a little tiny toy, a mochi mochi, amigurumi, those things, anything that qualifies for, you know, as tiny works for me. And I think anything that works for me will also qualify you in the Naughty Knitwits knit along for the Stuff It knit along. So that would be fun. And hopefully I have put the hashtags for all these things on the screen, which I'm planning on doing. And in the meanwhile, I hope you have a wonderful week. And you have lots and lots of time to do all the crafting that brings you joy. And I will see you next week. Thank you so much for joining me. And, show notes for this podcast will be in the Ravelry group for the Flame and Fiber podcast. So check out the Ravelry group and join, please. You need to be a member to participate in the knit along, so you might as well join. And if you want notification of these podcasts being up on YouTube, you can subscribe. I squee every time I get a subscriber, so that would make me very happy. But anyway, have fun. Have a great week. Talk to you next week. Bye.